Hello, massage nerds. Today I'm going to be doing lesson 10, muscles of mandibular movement and head and neck movement. And I want you to meet Siri. I named her Siri and she doesn't talk to me. I actually asked the cosmetology department and they donated this for us. So I'm very grateful. Thank you very much. That, you know, I knew I wasn't going to find anybody that was going to let me draw the, you know, facial muscles on their face. So anyway, I drew on her, and this is going to help for future classes. So we're going to talk about the facial muscles first. And, you know, we have over 43 muscles, you know, on the face. And we have over 10,000 different expressions that we can make, you know, from happy to sad to pouting to, you know, surprise. So that's a lot, 10,000 facial expressions that we can make with 43 muscles. So let's start by let's talk about the occipital frontalis. Remember, think of the name. What is the name telling you? Occipital frontalis is it originates on the occipital, you know, part of your head, and then it goes up and it goes all the way, you know, onto right above the eyebrows. And this is the frontalis, this is the frontalis, this is the occipital, and it's connected by the epicranial aponeurosis. So this one is the one that raises your eyebrows, you know, like when you're flirting with somebody, hey baby, you know, and you're raising your eyebrows, it's your it's your occipital frontalis muscle. So then we have your orbicularis oculi, and let me see, orbicularis is nothing more than small circle. So anytime, and it's a sphincter, anytime that you have orbicularis in it, it's, you know, circular, because it means small circle. The orbicularis oculi is for your winking muscle. You know, that's another one for flirting, or, you know, closing your eye, one eye at a time, or closing both eyes. Because remember, all the muscles that I draw, you do have them on both sides, okay? So this is the orbicularis oculi, and that's your winking muscle. Your orbicularis oris is your mouth, you know, around your mouth, and this is your kissing muscle, you know, when you're gonna kiss somebody. So this is your kissing muscle. I did not draw the platysma because the platysma would have covered too much of this here, but the platysma originates like underneath the deltoid and pec major, right under here by the clavicle, and then it inserts underneath the mandible. That one is your pouting muscle, because, you know, when you're pouting, it brings it down. It's a muscle like covers your chest here and goes up. I probably hit my microphone, didn't I? But anyway, it's a muscle that covers your chest and it goes right up underneath your mandible. That's the platysma, and that's known as the pouting muscle. Right here you have your zygomaticus, which is right, obviously originates on the zygomatic arch, and it inserts right at the upper lip. This is the one that gives you dimples. There's a split right here. When there's a split right here, which is actually a mutation, so it's actually very rare for people to have dimples. So it's more of, you know, that makes you very different. So when the muscle pulls up, that's what causes the indentation, and that's where you get dimples from. Then you have, let's talk about the temporalis muscle. You know, it originates in the temporal fossa, and then it inserts on the mandible. And this one goes underneath the zygomatic arch. So it goes underneath the zygomatic arch and inserts, you know, at the coronoid process of the mandible. And then you have your masseter. Your masseter muscle is your strongest muscle in the body. It can exert up to 200 pounds when you're chewing, you know, depending whether you're using molars or incisors. So this is the strongest muscle, and then is the uterus. You know, the uterus has to contract really strong to push that baby out. And then the gluteus maximus. The gluteus maximus is the largest, strongest, but for this being such a small muscle, it exerts, and it is considered the strongest muscle in the body, the masseter. And then moving to the other side, we've got your lateral pterygoid and your medial pterygoid. Your medial pterygoid is very similar, almost, you know, the same as the masseter muscle. These originate in the sphenoid bone. Remember, the sphenoid bone is behind your eyes, you know. So this originate by the lateral side of the sphenoid bone, and then insert the lateral pterygoid inserts at the TMJ. So it's very important that when you have a client that's having problems with TMJ, if you want to do the intraoral massage, you know, of course you wear a glove and you go inside the mouth, and you want to make sure and, you know, go this far, you know, very gentle, because, you know, that really does hurt. So you want to make sure and work the TMJ, you know, and you would work out the medial pterygoid, you know, even with the outside hand. And then, of course, the masseter, you know, you would also work the masseter on both sides. And also you have your parotid gland. Your parotid gland is the largest salivary gland, and it's right here. You can, you know, close to the earlobe. You want to be careful not to put too much pressure on that, because there is the parotid gland is a large salivary gland. So you know the difference. You know, what you can do is you can ask your client to kind of bite down, and that way you can distinguish where the masseter muscles are, you know, on both sides. And did I mention that the orbicularis means a little circle? So I think that's it for the facial muscles. And, you know, we do have 43 facial muscles, and we have over 10,000, you know, facial expressions that we make. So, you know, the face is really complex, you know, all the facial expressions that we can make, from smiling to pouting to frowning, you know. And it takes approximately 12 muscles for smiling and 11 for frowning. And, you know, I found a difference from different sources, because I use my book, and then I also use other apps like the Trail Guide to the Body, and, you know, sometimes even Google. I found three different sources that said three different things. You know, one said 12 to smile and 11 to frown. Another one said 10 to smile and 6 to frown. And then I found something else that said 26 to smile and 62 to frown. So do your own research, guys. I always say, you know, check it out. Another thing that I just want to tell you about, this is useless information, is that the thinnest skin of your body is over your eyelids. You know, it does have all three layers, like, you know, however, it is the thinnest, you know, the thinnest of your body, that skin. So now let's, so these are the facial mandibular movements. And let's talk about that. So let's talk about that. Depression is when you're opening up your mandible. Depression is opening up your mandible. You're depressing your mandible now. So this one, it takes the lateral pterygoid and the platysma. Remember, the platysma is this muscle here. So it's pulling your mandible down, correct? And then elevation is when you close your mouth. So you're depressing. Now you're elevating. So that would be the temporalis and the masseter, because they're pulling it shut now. Now they're pulling it back up. So that'd be the temporal, the masseter, and the medial pterygoid. Okay, now for protraction is when you stick your mandible out. Now the maxilla does not move. Remember, the maxilla is two bones and it does not move. The only one that moves is the mandible. So protraction is sticking your chin out. That's protraction. And that's the masseter pulling it out, and the lateral and medial pterygoids. And retraction, putting it back, you know. So what do you think that would do? Is that would be the temporalis, is, you know, retracting it back. So this is, you know, protraction, retraction. Now excursion is the medial and lateral pterygoids, and this is excursion, when you move your mandible sideways. So that's excursion, you know, when you move your mandible just one side. And I do ask my clients to do that when I am doing the intraoral massage. I ask them, I don't say excursion because they don't know, but I know it's called excursion. So they, you know, they move their mandible laterally, and that's from the medial and the medial and lateral pterygoids do that movement. So that is for the mandible movements. So now let's move to the head and neck movements. Right here, you've got your SCM, which is short for sternocleidomastoid. If you can say sternocleidomastoid three times, you know your medical terminology. So sternocleidomastoid has two origins. The one on the sternum, sterno, clito for clavicle, and then mastoid, because it inserts right at the mastoid process. So sternocleidomastoid is this muscle, and of course you have it on both sides. And this one's known as the praying muscle, because when both of them, you engage both of them, it's the one that helps you to bow your head, you know, for respect or for praying. So it's called the praying muscle. And the splenius capitis is the mirror image of the SCM. So the splenius capitis, you know, this one originates in C7 to T1, 2, 3, 4, and I couldn't draw the, you know, the thoracic, so it's pretty low down here. So it goes, you know, from around here, and then also inserts at the mastoid process. So if this one flexes the neck forward, guess what this one does? The splenius capitis will, you know, extend. So you've got your splenius capitis, and then you've got your splenius cervicis, and this one originates from T3, 4, 5, 6, and then it inserts and the second and the first, second, and third cervicals. So that's the splenius capitis, splenius cervicis, sternocleidomastoid. Now let's talk about the scalenes. The scalenes is a set of three muscles that originate from the transverse processes of the cervicals. So you've got your scalenes anterior, and that one originates from C3, 4, 5, and 6, and it inserts on the first rib, you know, on the anterior part. And then you have your scalenes medius, and that one originates from C2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7, and it originates in the transverse processes of C2 through C7, and it goes in the middle part. And then the posterior scalenes originates from 5, 6, and 7, and it inserts a little bit more posterior. Now the scalene muscles assist also with breathing. And this one inserts the scalene posterior, inserts on the second rib. The other two insert on the first rib, you know, under the clavicle, and this one inserts in the second rib. So these muscles right here, the scalenes, are very important for you to work them. For people that, you know, might have thoracic outlet is, you know, we have major, you know, we have a plexus of muscles that go between, you know, there's a little triangle right here, and this little triangle, and you can see it perfect right here, this is soft tissue between the SCM and the splenius capitis, and you have your scalenes going through here, and you have major, you know, nerves that go through here. You know, your axillary nerve, your median nerve, your radial nerve, your ulnar nerve, your muscular cutaneous nerve, they go through here, and sometimes they get trapped by the scalenes. So I have a video that you might want to watch that I show how to work the scalenes, because you need to have, you know, training. You need to have either neuromuscular or medical massage training, you know, because you don't want to put pressure if you don't know what you're doing. So these muscles can entrap the nerves, and they also elevate. They help with respiration. They're muscles of respiration also. They help the diaphragm because they lift your ribs up, right? So these are, along with the pec minor, these also help with respiration and the intercostals. So now let's talk about the movements of the head and neck. So you have your flexion, which flexion would be forward, and that's your sternocleidomastoid and scalenes anterior and scalenes, you know, medius. And then for extension, you know, that would be your back muscles pulling from the back. That would be your splenius capitis, splenius cervicis, your trapezius, and your longissimus. And then for lateral rotation is, and this is the way, you know, like when you're working on your client, you know, that you should be, you know, lateral flexion. You should be flexing this way, so that when you're turning your head, you know, to this ear to shoulder, that's your trapezius, your levator scapulae, which we did that, you know, the levator scapulae that goes from the scapula and inserts, you know, right here on the cervicals. I'm sorry, it originates from the cervicals, C1, 2, and 3, and 4, and then it inserts on the, I'm sorry, I haven't done that lesson in a while, in the scapula. So you've got your levator scapulae, your SCM, your sternocleidomastoid, and your scalenes, and your I reset that, the capitis and the cervicis, that is for lateral flexion. Now for rotation, this is head rotation. Oh, that felt good. I just popped my neck. So that again is the SCM, the trapezius, the scalenes anterior, and cervus, and the cervices and capitis, the splenius cervices and capitis. Also, that is for rotation. So I think that's pretty much it. Oh, the occipital suboccipitals, there's 8 suboccipitals, 4 on each side, and I didn't draw those because it was really hard to draw on, you know, underneath her hair, but they look like little spiders right here, and these are considered the ghost headache muscles. So make sure that when you are working on people, especially if they have occipital headaches, you know, make sure you work the suboccipitals, you know, all of these muscles. Now you understand why you guys have to work, you know, the neck, why so many people, especially right now with people looking down, you really, you know, want to work the splenius capitis, cervices, you know, the SCM right here, the mastoid process, all the scalenes, you know, down the lamina groove. You know, I try to do the cervicals, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Remember, the C7 is the most prominent. So these are your cervicals. There are 7 of them. And so anyway, this is the occipital frontalis because it goes from the occiput to the front, to the, you know, to the frontal. So here is Siri. She let me work with her very well. I hope this, you know, was fun for you guys. It was fun for me. Let me tell you, it was really fun drawing on, you know, on this mannequin. And so this is going to be your homework, guys. This is lesson 10. You know, we only have one more to go, you know, which is lesson 11, and I'm going to split it into two. And I can't believe that we've come this far. We're almost done with kinesiology. And I'll continue making other videos. And I finally learned getting better at drawing the muscles, and we're almost done. But anyway, I hope this helped. This is going to be your homework, guys. And thank you for your support, for your kindness, for your messages. And until the next time, create a great day.